How many of you have recently turned to the book of Numbers? So there's this crazy story in it. Maybe you've heard it before, but probably not. It's not necessarily one we tell all that often. But there was a prophet named Balaam, and the people of Israel were coming into the land of the Moabites. And the king of the time's name was Balak, just to make it more confusing for us English speakers. So Balak sent a group of men to Balaam to ask the prophet to curse the people of Israel so that he might fight against them and be victorious. Of course, God intervenes and tells Balaam, don't do it, don't go with them. He sends Balak's ambassadors back, and Balak says, no, go a second time. And so they go a second time and say, no, Balaam, come. Our king will give you much gold, much praise and honor, title, a land even. And again, the Lord came to Balaam at night and said, don't do it. Or go with them, maybe. But do what I tell you. And so Balaam rises in the morning, saddles his donkey, and goes with the group of men. And it says that the Lord is angered at the actions of either Balaam or Balak. It gets a little fuzzy, but regardless, an angel of the Lord stands in the midst, in the way of Balaam on the path. But the interesting thing is Balaam can't see him. See, only the donkey can see the angel of the Lord. And what's fascinating is the donkey knows what's up. See, as Balaam approaches the angel, the donkey, fearing for its own life, goes off into the field. And Balaam strikes the donkey and gets him back onto the path. And as they get closer to the angel, that the donkey is feeling more and more fear. And the donkey scrapes Balaam's leg up against a rock, and Balaam strikes the donkey again. And now they're mere feet from the angel. And the donkey will go no further. Maybe you've heard, stubborn as a mule. But the donkey at this time lays down. And Balaam strikes the donkey a third time. And at this moment, the Lord opens the donkey's mouth. And the donkey turns to Balaam and says, why do you keep hitting me? Have I not been your faithful animal all these years? Open your eyes and look in front of you. And in that moment, Balaam sees the angel of the Lord. Friends, welcome to another session of our teaching. I'm Pastor Luke from the United Methodist Church here in Shenandoah and Hamburg. This is a story that's always been near and dear to my heart, just because of how absurd it is. But I think it gives us insight into a reality that all of us face, or at least are, I would hope, enraptured by. See, Balaam couldn't see the angel of the Lord. He didn't know the imminent danger that he was in. It took an act of God for him to be aware of what was happening. And as we start to talk about and continue to talk about discernment, friends, I think that's where we are as well. We don't necessarily have eyes to see or ears to hear. And even as we talked about fasting and prayer as methods to get us into the right state or the right atmosphere or the right place to be able to start to hear from God, if we can't hear or see, then there's not much we can do. But friends, something I found interesting is that we all have ears and eyes. Yeah, I know. I get it, right? You could take that statement literally and think I'm crazy, either crazy or unintelligent for saying it. But friends, we all have spiritual eyes and spiritual ears. And it's an old understanding of poetry that I think would serve us well today. See, back in ancient Greece, it was said that the poets were where you found wisdom. Not necessarily the philosophers that came later, not necessarily the priests, they served a different function. No, it was the poets who you went to if you wanted to know how life actually worked. And see, friends, what's fascinating to me is that in many ways, that holds true. The Psalms are our collection of poetry. And it's not the only one, but it's the one that we have in Scripture. And what's fascinating about poetry is that to do it well, I've found the ones who can do it best are those who can look at a situation, study it, see it for what it truly is, find ways that that image or that moment fits into more areas of life than we had first given it credit for. See, friends, I'm convinced it's not even just poetry. See, we all have this ability, whether it's poetry and your ability to see situations in life, or whether it's art and you can study an image or an object and replicate it onto canvas or paper, or maybe it's music that you can hear the melody in your head or feel the harmony in your bones and you're able to bring that and breathe life into it. But it's not just art, is it? Maybe you're able to look at the clouds and tell us what weather is coming next. Or maybe you can look at an ear of corn and say whether it's ripe or not before you husk it. Or perhaps you can smell when the food is ready, which is not a skill that I have. See, friends, when we talk about awareness in our discernment, when we talk about the ability to hear or see, in many ways, we already do this. This is what Jesus says when he cries out in frustration. You can tell the weather by the sky, but you don't know what season it is in the kingdom of God. And yet I'm convinced that we all have this ability to slow down, to listen, to really look, to really take notice. And friends, that's the secret. That's the bit of discernment that it takes to really hear the voice of God. What would have happened if Balaam wasn't so in a hurry or so frustrated? Would it have taken an act of God to open his eyes? What would have happened if Saul in the New Testament hadn't been so blinded by his strict adherence to tradition, but that he took the time and had the humility and graciousness to listen to the good news? Would he have had to have been blinded by Christ on his way to Damascus? So friends, as you continue on this journey, as you continue to learn and ponder on what it means to discern, to hear the voice of God, to figure out where the Spirit is moving, this week, I want you to ask yourself these questions. What are you really aware of? Or asked in a different way, what are you able to see or smell or hear or feel that other people have a hard time with? Like I said, maybe that's music, maybe that's cooking, maybe that's seeing a shape as it truly is. The second question I would ask is, what would it take to hear and slow down, to to simplify your life so that there's not so much noise in it that you might be able to see the Spirit? And my third question is this. Can you take those skills you already have in art, in gardening, in cooking, in science, in reading, whatever. Can you take those skills you already have and apply them to discernment? Friends, I'll leave you with this story. I had a man come over, one of the members in our congregations. See, I had this jet ski in my garage, and the engine wouldn't work. It was my sister's, and I said, foolishly, I said, I'll take a look at it and fix it. So I had him come over and look at it, and of course it was shot. There was no hope. But as he was leaving, my wife was going to run groceries, and as she turned the key in the ignition, it was a wet, misty day out, and there was a squeal that I had heard before. But this man's head shot up, and he cocked it so he could hear a little better. And he said, "Your serpentine belt, you should take a look at it." Friends, may we be like that mechanic in our spiritual lives and throughout our days. May we be able to hear the voice of God. May we slow down and listen. Because friends, prayer only works. Fasting only works. We can only hear the voice of God when we pay attention. Go with God, and God will go with you. Amen.